Hey, everyone ever. And really? You're gonna laugh at that?
I'm sorry. That was very dour. I wasn't expecting it to be dour.
What's a dour topic?
No, I know, but we've been laughing up until this
point. Laughing it up till this point, and then I guess I was bringing it down.
Yeah, you brought it way down without any indication that that's the direction we were going.
With the intro.
But now that I know, I'll be prepared.
Prepared?
If you want to do it again. Yeah.
I'll try it again. Hey, everyone ever. See, now I don't remember what the next line is. I thought it was fine because it's a grave situation.
It was like the least possible thing I was expecting.
The least
at the
possible
opening.
Thing?
Yeah, well,
is that a sentence?
The least possible tone that you would open with after having made some really funny comments.
Quite
up
good.
To this point, yeah. we've been having a laugh. A riot here,
a
Tim.
A riot. An old-time riot.
But
and then I opened up and killed the room, is what you're saying.
Well, yeah.
I infected the room, maybe. With,
that's about right.
All right.
But I guess that's the point, so.
Yeah.
I'm ready now. I won't break.
Won't break.
I hope.
All right. I'll try it again.
All right.
Now I'm teetering on, do I do it really big, and that's funny, or do I do what I've been doing and then feel self-conscious?
I had to bite my finger because your pause got longer and longer, and so I couldn't hold it in.
So you put your finger in your mouth.
I did, and I bit hard.
Bit your finger. Okay.
I touched it to my face and to my tongue and to my teeth.
You should sanitary wipe those.
I should.
With
the
sanitary napkin.
Yeah.
All right. Hey everyone ever, and welcome to 20th Century Pop, the show where we try to understand the present while living in the past. My name is Tim Blevins.
And I am Bob Canning. And Tim, we're starting this off with a little dark tone, aren't we, sir?
I think that's appropriate. Yeah. I mean, I think we started with a lot of false starts and then got to the dark tone. But yeah, I think these are... It's grim, I think. And I know you and I have been talking prior to starting this, but it's a pretty grim world we're living in. And I don't know how much of that we should pass through the mic here. Because, I don't know, people come to... Are you still listening to podcasts, still watching TV? Is that something you're doing as a distraction?
TV is a big distraction. trying to distract...
So it's a distraction that's trying to distract. So in essence, it's putting you right back on track.
Yeah, I guess that's how that math would work. Sure. No. I don't know. Like, I'm trying to be as normal as possible. And I don't think we've actually talked about why we're doing this, but everyone who's listening at this stage
knows. Yeah, I imagine
knows.
That most of the listeners are going to know.
Yeah.
That we're in,
but in case perhaps they're coming to this, you know, a year later.
Mm-hmm. This is I hope they can.
A little pod capsule of our time here in March 2020.
There's a bit of a pandemic kind of sweeping the world. A lot of people staying home, a lot of people choosing not to go out, a lot of the word quarantine kind of being bandied around, and it's worldwide. This is nationwide, worldwide. And so I guess, yeah, part of me is wondering, do we acknowledge that on the podcast? Are these forms of escapism? But also, is escapism something that even works right now? Is that something that kind of like, are you finding you can drone some of it out? You were just saying with like TV and stuff when you go to that?
Yeah, I can. And it's just the normal routine, just sticking to the as normal as possible. So like I really don't get TV time, as we call it in this family's household. Until the kids are in bed. The kids have TV time.
We call it a boob tube brahaha.
Is that what you call it?
Boob tube brahaha?
Yeah. That'll work.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's like I've been trying to avoid, although, you know, you can't, but trying to avoid constant news on this pandemic, on this COVID-19. But you also want to be informed. You want to know what's going on. So you check in and... It's just hard to get away from. So yeah, I will turn to some pop culture entertainment to try and forget what's happening for a short amount of time.
Well, I hope this isn't one of the pieces of pop culture entertainment you turn to, because today's topic, I think, is coming out of a little bit of what's going on right now, a little bit of a feeling. I mean, I'll be honest, there's this sort of apocalyptic feel to everything going on right now. There's sort of this almost cinematic end times mentality that this is a big ordeal. This is a massive change to society. This is the viral outbreak or the alien spore or the artificial intelligence. This is something that is infecting us beyond our expectations, controls, on such a wide playing field that life will never be the same again. That's kind of
It feels like that.
Of course,
I gotta hope that's not entirely true. That it won't never be the same again. I know that's grammatically incorrect, but. Yeah, that's in this moment, in this time right now, it's hard to imagine anything being normal again. It's strange.
It's hard to imagine. It's almost like what do we have as a basis to imagine that? Because I feel like thinking things will just go right back to normal is kind of being blind to what's going on. It's a way of silencing a lot of the horrors that are occurring, but also the outcome of something like this, this scope, this scale, this size, has only really been for me reflected in pop culture. You know, there's comic books, there's novels, there's movies, there's even songs that kind of touch on this feel of a global threat and the change of a global threat. And honestly, a lot of that entertainment doesn't really necessarily turn out for the best.
Right.
You know, why would it? And I think because of that, that kind of prompted me today to think like what we could look at approach are sort of some of these pop culture apocalypses, kind of things from the entertainment of our youth, be they movies, again, comic books, whatever, that touched on these ideas of an end of the world scenario or a mass change to society, or the word that I keep throwing around, an apocalypse. I mean, does that kind of ring with you? Does that make sense to you as like a topic?
It does. It does. And in fact, before this really escalated about 2 weeks ago, and it was just bubbling up, you know, with news out of China, I think you and I joked about the movie Outbreak. And I thought about watching the movie Contagion. And it just was like, this is just felt like what I should be turning to is this pop culture apocalypse type stuff that we would watch. Now that I'm more in the midst of it and it's so much more real and happening, the thought of watching one of those things turned me off. In fact, my wife and I watched the trailer for Contagion to see if we wanted to watch it one night. And just the trailer alone had so many moments that are actually kind of happening right now. We were both like, nope, that's not escapism. That's right where we are. I don't want to watch this. So it's strange how it's like, before it became real, it was something I enjoyed. It's like, let's watch this. Outbreak can't be fun. And now it's like, I just want to stay away from it.
Well, Outbreak's the example I remember. I don't know Contagion. You keep mentioning that.
That's a more recent 21st century film.
Okay, yeah, I don't know that. But I know Outbreak. It was a mid-90s movie. But in the 90s, Outbreak was also sort of a cautionary tale, sort of a warning of things that could happen. I think there was a book out at the time called The Hot Zone I'm going to get my facts wrong here, but I think it was about the spread of Ebola and viruses like that, and movies that attempt to siphon or approach or deal with these bigger ideas of disease and destruction have always been attractive to me. And they are attractive right now too, because they're a way of toying, testing, and experiencing these feelings, you know, in the past without having to go through. But right now I still think it's a safe way of kind of testing out these feelings. Like, I'm not going to sit down and watch Outbreak because I don't want to sit down and watch Justin Hoffman in a hazmat suit. But there are plenty of things, that's the other side of it too, plenty of things I'm watching are kind of like you're saying with this Contagion trailer, are kind of coming to the surface where I am seeing and hearing little things that remind me of the now. I'm not escaping from it. You know, I'm very much in the moment in these little mentions of a character with a cough or something with the CDC or a disease, you know, all these little buzzwords and little plot points, they come to the surface and they have a different weight.
Yeah.
But I think that's good. I think that's powerful fiction, that's powerful pop culture. And I think that's necessary because I don't know if we should be trying to escape what's going on right now. We want to distract ourselves because we can't think about it 24 hours a day. So maybe there is lighter fare to find out there. Thanks, Netflix, for taking Friends away. But there's other shows. One could seek out at least the first two episodes of Two Guys, a Girl, and a Pizza Place on YouTube.
I'm watching New Girl, if that matters. I know that's not 20th century, but that's what we've been streaming.
All right, and you've got that, so good for you. I've always been drawn to pop culture that deals with horrible futures, horrible apocalypses, because that's what most of them are. They set it enough in the future that we haven't quite reached it yet, so you can kind of play around with it with this anticipation of coming up to it. So, yeah, today we're coming to the show with some examples of this, some things from childhood or maybe young adulthood, you know, past century, that deals with a variation or a view of global apocalyptic themes in like a comic book or a film. Do you want to start off? Do you have an example you want to bring up?
Sure. I will start off. So the movie that I'm going to talk about is the Terry Gilliam directed 12 Monkeys.
What year is this?
What year do you think it is?
1996.
That's the future, James. Do you think you're living in the future?
I'm simply trying to gather information to help the people in the present trace the path of the virus.
We're not in the present now.
This is a place for crazy people.
I'm not saying you're not mentally ill. For all I know, you're crazy as a loon.
The army of the 12 monkeys, they're the ones that spread the virus.
Monkeys?
You've been living in a meticulously constructed fantasy world, and that world is starting to disintegrate.
You haven't become addicted to that dying world?
No, sir.
He needs help.
I think I'm crazy when people start dying next month.
I don't belong here.
You're here because of the system.
I know some things that you don't know.
Yes, my son.
You sent me to the wrong year.
You're certain of that?
Science ain't an exact science.
You had a bullet from World War I in your leg, James. How did it get there?
I don't know.
You're a trained psychiatrist. You know the difference between what's real and what's not.
You said that I had delusions. You said you could explain.
I'm trying to.
I want the future to be unknown.
I can help you get you out.
We're all monkeys.
The thing mutates! We live underground!
They're watching you.
I just want to do my part to get us back on top in charge of the planet.
So basically, 12 Monkeys is takes place in the future where a virus has basically wiped out most of civilization. There are some people that have survived, and at some point along the path, they've developed time travel, and there are a government-type organization or some scientists that are selecting, I don't know if they're prisoners or people who were survivors. I can't remember the exact details, but they're sending certain people back in time to try and find the source of this virus so they can find a cure for it and maybe come back. I guess they're all living underground now, and so they want to come back. And so the movie is about a character named James Cole, who gets sent back in time. He is
portrayed by Look Who Talking's 2's Bruce Willis.
Bruce Willis, yes. So he goes back in time, and there's a couple things that happen, but he eventually hits back in time and stays back in time and tries to warn people. They think he's crazy. He's put in an insane asylum. He befriends a doctor who starts to believe him, or at least wants to help him. And the reason I bring this movie up for this discussion is because I feel like we are in the flashback of 12 Monkeys right now. Like, that's where my mind often goes with the news reports and what I'm reading online, and just how it started, you know, back in December, I think, where we first started hearing of it, and it slowly is escalating. And then, you know, different rules have to be put in place and all this stuff is happening. You don't see that in 12 Monkeys. You see the oblivious people walking around, not knowing what the future holds. We've already seen the future in the movie. We see that they're living underground, that they're trying to send people back, and they're kind of tearing people's brains apart because that's part of what happens with the time travel. They're putting people in danger to try and solve this puzzle, this virus puzzle. And for me, I just keep having these images as I'm going through my day that we're living in that flashback, that we're living in that time before it all just falls apart, the apocalypse that you're talking about. And that just is kind of scary to me. It's just weird to have that feeling. Because I know this movie really well, and I've seen it a lot. I haven't seen it a lot recently. I unfortunately didn't have a chance to watch it before this podcast, as I wanted to. But that's the eerie feeling I have right now, that we're just one Bruce Willis away from the end of the world.
We're just one the whole 10 yards Bruce Willis away from the end of the world. Do you think the idea of 12 Monkeys, the movie, is informing your feelings right now, or you just think that your feelings are reflected by the movie?
No, I think they're informing my feelings. You know, I've had that pop culture experience. I know the beats of the movie, and I know the beats of this type of story. I know it wasn't from the 20th century, so forgive me for mentioning it, but I've always enjoyed the Planet of the Apes remake, the first one with James Franco. They have that interesting through line. I don't know if you've seen that.
I have not, no.
You know, you see a newspaper article about these astronauts taking off, and then you see news reports about them losing contact with the astronauts. It's just this background thing, you know? And so it's just kind of an interesting, you know, as a viewer and having a historical reference with the previous Planet of the Apes movie, you know what that is. You know that those are the astronauts that will eventually come back to Earth, and the planet will be overrun with apes.
Damn dirty apes.
Yeah, but it's so subtle. It's a neat little subtle thing that they throw in there. And I feel like I'm feeling those beats. I'm feeling just these subtle things that are happening, a subtle reference to this disease and this virus, and a subtle reference to, you know, how children maybe aren't as affected. And then in my head, I go to, it's like, okay, our apocalypse, our future, our real timeline here is going to be wiping out anyone over 24, and our planet is just always children until they get old enough that the virus affects them, and then they die off. And so I'm having these types of movie pop culture type visuals of what's going on.
And I wonder if that's what informs some of these versions of the apocalypse as being entertaining, because the movies, then the 12 Monkeys itself, the part we're not seeing is this part, right? Like, he travels back to before, if I remember, there's a vial of something that gets released or something. Yeah. I don't know. But there's a...
Right at the end of the movie.
What a lot of these movies and versions of pop culture aren't showing you is the actual event. It's a before and after kind of picture. You know, I'm thinking of, like, in The Terminator. That's set before the nuclear apocalypse. We see a... we see a daydream of the apocalypse happening, but our main reference is the future war and the present day, and the actual event is kind of almost what they're cautionary tales. We have to stop it. Is it James Cole? John Cole? What's the
James,
name of?
James Cole.
James Cole comes back in time to try to stop it. So there is this idea of, with all that happening and following that story, the world at large is unaware of it. The world at large doesn't know it's going to happen, and the world at large. I mean, that's scary to live in that sort of naive sensibility.
Right.
And for you to now be feeling like we're kind of, that we just went through that, and now we're in this part.
Yeah.
That's unnerving.
It's very unnerving. And it's where my mind kind of gravitates to. It's hard because it's like I'm trying to approach it in a realistic manner, but I've seen this movie. I've experienced a lot of this type of pop culture, and so my mind likes to wander, and it's hard to control it, and it just kind of develops these little movie scenarios that we might be leading to.
Now, so do you think those scenarios are irrational?
No, I think they're irrational. But I don't know. Like, I want them to be irrational. I think that's what I'm thinking. I want this to be able to be controlled and taken care of. I want all the things that people are saying is going to help it to happen. I want the sun to come out and the heat to burn the virus away. I want, you know, all those things to happen because I really just want to get back to a little bit of normalcy. And I certainly don't want a 12 Monkeys future ahead of us.
Yeah. But do you think there is one? Do you think that's what this is?
I can't rationally believe that there is one. No.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Now, if you were younger and this might be hard to say because you have to do some play acting, if what's going on right now was happening to you, say, what were we, 20 when 12 Monkeys came out?
Uh-huh.
If this was happening when you were 20, do you think your perception might be a little different? Do you think, oh, this movie's prophetic, oh, this is could happen? Or do you think it's still, because it's entertainment, it makes the outcome less likely?
I don't know. That is a hard, you're right. It's hard to kind of put myself in that situation. I probably, because this is what I was want to do at that age, I probably would be more apt to say it was prophetic and just kind of buy into the coming apocalypse. Just because I think at that time, that's just kind of who I was. It was like, it was more entertaining to go that route than to try to be the rational human.
Now, was the fear with the apocalypse ever, I'm not going to make it through this? Or was the fear kind of like the world's going to collapse and then I'm going to be in the post-apocalyptic world? Because I think there's a middle part to that narrative. And maybe they talk about that. Let me bring up one of the, there was a movie that I was thinking about this weekend and actually ended up watching on Monday, so yesterday, in preparation for the show, that I think kind of deals with a little bit of this idea of being 20 and kind of perceiving something. Are you familiar with the movie Night of the Comet?
By name only.
What do you know about just the name?
That there is a movie entitled Night of the Comet.
Yeah, it's a 1984 kind of like it's a horror movie, I think. It takes place in California. And it takes place on the eve of Earth passing through this tail of a comet, the one from the title. This comet that there's this narration at the beginning passes through the galaxy once every 3,000 years or something. And it's this kind of thing where you know, it's a countdown to it approaching. The world is excited for it. I think it's around Christmas season. It's not quite Christmas Eve, but it's around that time of year. So as the movie opens, the idea is that we know the comet's coming. We know the Earth is going to pass through it. And everybody is outside, you know, like a New Year's celebration waiting for it. We have to see the comet. And they're all in their excess with their clothes and their fancy parties and just standing there all staring at the night sky waiting for this to happen.
Did you ever wonder what it would be like to be one of the last people on Earth?
We're talking ghost town!
Who would you see?
There's nobody. I mean, there's nobody. Ah!
What would you do?
Hey, I'm sorry if the end of the world makes me a little nervous.
Where would you go?
The stars are open!
Well, get ready to find out, because the comet is coming into your orbit.
The legal drinking age is now 10, but... you will need ID. Let's be real.
It's the Night of the Comet.
What do you give me if I come back?
Texas?
Night of the Comet.
I'll be taking requests from all you teenage comet zombies.
The night the teenagers ruled the world.
Yeah!
Night of the Comet.
The burden of civilization is on us.
Fiction, isn't it?
The story, what we're actually doing, we're following two characters, two pretty amazing, actually, movie characters, if you get a chance to see the movie. One whose name is Regina, who's a 20-year-old who works as a theater usher at the local movie theater. And she has a younger sister by the name of, and I'm missing my notes here, I should have been more prepared, I'm sorry.
I'm so disappointed in you.
I know. Samantha, her younger sister, they live together in a house. And at the night of the coming comet, Regina has to work. She works at this movie theater. And we see her there. And we see that she kind of goes into the projection room. And there's a guy there. And they end up making out and having sex and spending the night in the lead-lined projector room. And Samantha, who had snuck out of her house to go to a party, came home early from the party and just kind of fell asleep in a storage shed, is her story, you find out later on. And I mention both of these things because what happens is neither one of them gets to witness the comet's passing. Neither one of them is part of the big crowds, the big masses of the world that went out to face this thing. And what they find out the next day as Regina leaves the movie theater in the morning, you know, getting ready to head home, is that when she steps outside, the world is silent. It's strangely foggy looking, strangely colored, like a vaporwave picture. There's nobody around, but there are, everywhere she looks, there's piles of clothes and this weird sort of orange dust kind of splintering out of the clothes. She makes it home and she finds Samantha, and Samantha relates to her how she slept over in the shed. And basically what they find out is that the night before, and they piece this together pretty quick. They're smart enough kids. But when the Earth passed through the comet, everyone who was outside exposed to sort of the tail of the comet was disintegrated into this weird kind of dust powder. And it's millions of lives gone, and that they might be the last two people on the planet. What's amazing about this story is that they're kind of okay with it. The idea is that the apocalypse happened around these two kids, and we're following them. So,
without spoiling it, is it a happy ending for them?
I think it's happy enough. I mean,
it sounds like it's almost a utopian fantasy. I mean, I don't know if
It's not utopian. It's a struggle to get through. But I mean, the movie's got a tone like Buckaroo Banzai or like Girls Just Want to Have Fun. It's got a comical tone to it. But I think it's depicting that life still goes on. You know, these two kids are not thrown by what happened. They're survivors, and they have the burden kind of civilization on their shoulders, and they're living life. Again, or continuing to live life, you know, on the planet. That's the thing. They don't slow down.
Yeah.
You know, like in Star Wars, where Luke's parents or adopted parents, aunt and uncle, get burnt alive, and that should probably shake him up, but he's just like, no, I'm going to go on this space adventure. That's the same kind of mentality. It's like the realistic story, I guess, would be mourning, but like there's something valiant in pursuing the narrative, pursuing the movie.
Having not seen it, It seems to have a different vibe than a lot of other movies where a lot of civilization gets wiped out, where the survivors end up fighting each other, becoming just crazed people who are constantly at war with each other.
Something about Night of the Comet that I think is important in a lot of the literature I turn to about the apocalypse that makes it bearable is that the characters are continuing on. You know, I'm not talking that they're the freedom fighters of like the Terminator movies, you know, or the cold stoic, whatever that is. I mean, these are people who are still trying to make their life work. They're not thrown. They're blind to. They're probably deluding themselves that this was a real world film, but they're finding that they can still cope with the bizarreness of such a tragic event. Like there's no way to be prepared for something like that. Just like there's no way to be prepared really to as a civilian or whatever we are to kind of process what's going on in the world right now. Having the world end around a character like that and then following the character forward gives a sense of hope.
Right.
Gives a sense of drive. Like I like that in a piece of pop culture bubblegum fantasy, really. I mean, because yeah, it's a hokey movie. It's a fun movie. It's a joke of a movie. But inherently, watching it as the world possibly burns around us, one could find in it a little bit of comfort that, well, you know, you'll get by. You'll push your way through. You'll make life as normal again. I mean, is that a theme you find coming up at all in any of the work that you're talking about?
Oh, for sure. Yeah, I mean, a lot of it is like what you're saying about the Terminator is like the freedom fighters or whatever, like fighting back on the thing that took away civilization. I think of like the Matrix and them fighting back against the machines.
That's not comforting, though, is it? Because that's
no,
that's
it's not comforting because it's dark and dismal. And then you've got and I'll be honest, I haven't seen recently any of the early Mad Max movies, but I believe that's got a similar vibe. And then you can have something like Waterworld. That was the other one that popped up. Waterworld and also Kevin Costner's other apocalyptic film, The Postman.
Well, those you were two. The one who saw The Postman. You and I were the ones who saw Waterworld. What about Waterworld is kind of what? Why did that one get you?
Well, I mean, it just the fact that Kevin Costner has these two post-apocalyptic films in his repertoire has always kind of stuck with me. I remember when they came out. It's just, you know, one aspect that we were thinking about, I don't know if we're really playing it up here, but we were talking about one of the angles. And it's like, well, if I had to pick an apocalyptic, post-apocalyptic world, where would I live? And I went back to Waterworld a couple times thinking about that. Because if you can put yourself a sweet boat together, you're pretty much set, I guess, you know?
When the elders say so, you can leave. And not before.
Oh, gills.
Mutation! Is there, what's the apocalypse in Waterworld?
You know, it's been, I've only seen it the one time, and maybe I've seen some clips of it here and there, but I'm not exactly sure what happens, why it happens, but essentially the world loses all of its land. It's just all water everywhere.
It's global warming, I assume.
That'd be my guess.
So it's realistic. It's a realistic portrayal. But that world doesn't seem threatening.
I mean, there are threats, but I was kind of playing through, you know, just off the top of my head, you know, the different movies. I don't think I'd really want to have to live in the Mad Max world. I don't want to live in the Matrix world. I don't like the future of 12 Monkeys, what that was showing me. And so it was either Waterworld, you know, which you can kind of spread yourself out and maybe kind of be on your own and left alone by the tyrants on the oil tankers. Or The Postman, which is just, I don't even know how it gets to this point because I've never actually seen all of The Postman. I've seen bits and things here. But basically it just looks like American wilderness that you're living in, and people seem to be getting by okay.
In the future, after the Great War, our civilization lies in ruin. Government does not exist. Technology has been erased, and everything man remembers is gone. Out of the chaos, a lawless army will arise to prey on the few survivors. Fire! But to a people who have lost their hope.
You are a dangerous man. I can see it in your eyes.
He will give them courage.
I have a feeling about you.
He will restore their memories of the past.
It's the individual that counts.
These people don't need dreams. They need help. Are you going to bring them that?
I want him bound. I want him dealt with.
He will unite them.
You have a gift, Postman.
With a message of freedom.
I challenge the leadership of the clan. You want a war? I'll give you...
A war! Kevin Costner, Academy Award-winning director of Dances with Wolves, brings you an epic new vision of our future.
There's gonna be new laws! There's gonna be peace!
Yeah, it's interesting that both of those movies are... I mean, I guess a massive change has wiped through the world, but you're right. People are surviving day by day. People are moving around. I guess I would wonder, you're talking about The Matrix. Which... Are you talking about the world in The Matrix? Or are you talking about the world outside of the grimy, drippy world with all the tubes they have to plug into them?
I'm talking about the real world where you're awake. Yeah. You're so awake from The Matrix.
That is unnerving. So I was going to say that the world in the computer, there's some solace or safety in that it's replicating familiar rhythms. But Waterworld and The Postman, societies exist there. I mean, Waterworld could just as well be a pirate movie on a different planet.
Right, right. You know, exactly.
Waterworld. So I know it ties into, and I think some time has passed. That's the other thing. And my assumption is some time has passed in Waterworld since the events that crumbled cities and things like that. But they're brighter movies. They're cheerier movies. You talk about the future of 12 Monkeys, which if I'm remembering right, and spoilers for 12 Monkeys, it ends a little, I guess the ending is open and to interpretation. I feel like it ends that the loop is closed and that the apocalypse is going to happen again. I know there's another way of looking at it that people have told me, but I feel like 12 Monkeys is horrifying because I feel like his actions to prevent it are part of what causes it, meaning it's a fixed destiny.
Right. Yep. That's how I've always seen 12 Monkeys.
And that's not a future we want to work to, even though we are seeing that some humans have survived past it.
Yeah.
The Transformers will return after these messages.
Hey, everyone ever. This is Tim Blevins, co-host of 20th Century Pop. And I wanted to talk to you for a minute about a band. Which band? How about that one band? That specific band. That only band that matters. I'm talking about Westerberg, Stinson, Mars, Dunlap, straight out of Twin Tone and not at all Soul Asylum. It's The Replacements, the most impactful band of my existence, and starting this April, I'm streaming a 5-day-a-week deep dive into figuring out why. It's every studio album in original order and one track at a time. That means talent show. That means color me impressed. That probably means Gary's got a boner. The show is called What's That Song? And you can hear the sincerity of it all when it debuts April 20th on Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Spotify, and probably some other podcast catcher. Visit the Not a Hologram homepage at nahpods.com and click on the link to subscribe from the very beginning. I'm becoming that person who talks about music all the time. And you can listen every day, except for the weekends, to What's That Song, premiering April 20th at nahpods.com. Not a hologram, it's a podcast.
Now return to the Transformers.
One of the first pieces, I think, of one of the first future apocalypses is that I keep saying that wrong, that I think really ingrained itself in me, that really kind of took hold. And I think it's because it permeated so much of an ongoing storyline, was the Days of Future Past storyline from Chris Claremont's 17 year run on Uncanny X-Men. Did you read Uncanny X-Men a bit? I know we lived together. I don't know if you ever read it as a comic series.
I read it when I lived with you. I can't recall. I mean, I was reading old. I thought it was older things. You were giving me the books to read. And I can't quite remember what the run was or what the storylines were. I don't think it was that. The one part that I do remember is that his name escapes me now, the guy that can turn to metal,
Colossus,
basically kind of befriended and worked with Magneto during the storyline that I was reading, and I think I was also when Wolverine had the adamantium removed from him and he was just bones.
Oh, yeah, I think that's the Fatal Attraction arc, like his body reheals as bones. But this idea of the Days of Future Past, it was really just two issues 141 and 142, that kind of told the story. And they came out in 1980, so I didn't even really actually read them when they came out. But as a storyline, I think it was a continually referenced concept in the ongoing storyline, even through today, I think. The story as it's told in the two issues splits itself between the modern day, which at that point was 1980, and a future date of 2013.
People are afraid. They want action. They want protection. They want revenge. The mutant control law is passed, calling for an army of sentinels. They march over the nation, seeking out mutants, hunting them down like animals.
Surrender, mutant!
Some fight back. But not for long. The sentinels herd the surviving mutants into detention camps. The camps are your final stop. You never leave. Never! But those who control the Sentinels don't stop with mutants. Eventually, they bring their new world order to all humans.
The rest of the world's nation, for some reason, isn't necessarily directly occupied by Sentinels, but they have been monitoring the situation from a distance. And as the story in 2013 that we're reading begins, the rest of the nation is preparing to launch an all-out nuclear assault on broken America to destroy this sentinel threat. And there's some mutants still surviving. They realize this. And so as the story goes, the future version of Kitty Pryde, which is one of the X-Men who can like phase through things. She's one of the younger X-Men, much older in 2013. She travels backwards in time to 1980 with the aim of stopping Mystique who is a shape-shifting mutant, from assassinating a presidential candidate named Robert Kelly, an action that the future has figured out is what sets their whole future in motion. It's always hung over the series because there's no real way to know if how the story wraps up alters the future events. So there's this unnerving story kind of hanging there that this could still come to pass.
Yeah.
It's an apocalypse aimed at class struggle. You know, in this case, it's a feared reaction to the mutants that prods the government into building these robots. And that's kind of frightening when you look at like our current administration and its need to pin the horrors on other countries. Trump the other day called this a Chinese virus.
Oh, I know.
Building up this sense of an exterior threat based on differences. And I mean, we've had concentration camps in this country before. We have designated people by different titles before, and that might happen again. And I think the storyline has always been kind of tinged in my mind with that idea being kind of the fall, ultimately being the nation's falling. Ultimately, this nation will fall apart because of one of these choices, and the rest of the world will have enough of us and just want to destroy us. And that aspect of the story, that future aspect, has always kind of been beat in my head as, yeah, when the apocalypse comes, we're going to have it coming, is kind of my feeling. Like it's horrible to say we deserve it, but it's an apocalypse of our own making. You know, we slipped up, we got greedy. I say we being the American power, whatever is in power. I don't mean to be identifying with that, but I don't know, something within the Days of Future Past story that is just saying, you know, humanity is responsible for its own demise. And I don't know, that I think plays into apocalyptic stories for me. They're cautionary tales.
Yeah. Do you get that vibe in our day-to-day today?
I mean, I'd be saddened if people I knew were killed by the virus. I'm saddened by the fear of that virus. But also, again, the feeling that, well, at least that's nature. What I fear is the human element in that. The human cause for it getting out of control. And then ultimately the human response. How humanity is going to deal with this. Is it going to enact martial law? Is it going to enact these weird concentration quarantine spots? I mean, it's probably not going to build giant towering robots to hunt down people with a cough, but I mean, that again, that's kind of looking, the apocalypse isn't the end of everything in that story, but it is sort of the change.
Yeah.
And that's, I mean, that's on my mind now. That's a fear of mine now.
And that's something I've heard a lot of people say or write about, is that nothing will be the same again.
Mm-hmm.
And that's even if everything goes well here, you know? So imagine if it doesn't go well, if we can't get control of this, to think that nothing will be the same again, and that this, we're living in the point of no return, the point where everything changes, is kind of unnerving.
We've done it before. I mean, it's happened before. Do you remember when New York was attacked? Do you remember when the Pentagon was attacked? Those were also...
And there was a lot of nothing will ever be the same again.
Exactly.
And it eventually got back to some sort of normalcy.
But it's not the same again. It's what they call the new normalcy.
Yeah.
That's shaking. And it took a while. And it didn't happen for everyone that way. And this is the same thing.
Right.
You know, the sweeping out of controlness of this mimics in a lot of ways the decisions that probably led to the attacks on New York. I'm not saying that this nation's the only guilty thing in the world, but also the response to that was a tragic downward spiral as well. And, you know, I forget that the whole point of apocalypse isn't always the, like, people are very happy to tell you, you know, it actually doesn't mean the end of the world. It means an unveiling of knowledge, a reveal of secret knowledge or something. And so that ties into this idea of a big change. But I don't know. I feel like a lot of this pop culture is prepping me for, yeah, two different extremes. You know, Night of the Comet, they very much hold on to the lifestyles they want in this new world. Days of the Future Past, 12 Monkeys, we're giving up what we had. It's all a memory. You know, it's like that photo that's carried around in the Terminator. This is done.
It's funny because it's like you mentioned Terminator, 12 Monkeys, Days of Future Past. They all involve time travel, you know? So it's all, like you're saying, it's all looking back and here's the memory of what was.
And it's all trying to change it.
And all trying to change it too, yeah.
And we don't really have that luxury in the real world, so I get why that comes up in the fiction, because that allows the world we have now to continue.
Right.
Do you have any other examples that you wanted to bring up?
I mean, those were really the ones I came with. Obviously, Planet of the Apes was another one I was thinking about. I kept going back to 12 Monkeys just because I just... You know, just like we used to do when we lived together in that basement apartment and we were like trying to write our own real life sitcom, I feel like in a lot of ways my head is writing its own 12 Monkeys right now. I'm in that moment where I'm going to suddenly run into James Cole trying to track down, you know, a plane to China so he can put an end to all of this. But it's strange.
Is it bad? Is it dangerous? Like, if you had access to 12 Monkeys, I know you said you didn't. Do you think you would have watched it?
Yeah, I would have watched 12 Monkeys. Maybe because it's more of a fantasy film with the time travel. But I wouldn't. I was saying, I can't remember if I said this when we started the show or before. I wouldn't watch Contagion right now. I don't think I want to watch Outbreak. I don't want to watch anything that's got a real reality to it, you know, where... You know, somebody had posted a still of Sanjay Gupta from CNN, and I couldn't tell, and they couldn't tell, was this the scene from Contagion, or is this what's happening right now? Because he guessed it in Contagion. So those are the kind of movies I'm avoiding, but I would have watched 12 Monkeys. I might still try and watch 12 Monkeys. Haven't seen that in a while.
But if they're reflecting, if something like Contagion, I know it's a this century movie, but something like Outbreak... If it's reflecting a real-world event and response, why avoid it? I mean, you're not avoiding the news, I imagine. You're watching the news maybe more than you should.
Yeah, I'm trying to avoid. I don't know, because I can't remember the ending to Contagion, but I...
Let's go Outbreak then, because again, it's more relevant to the time period.
Okay, we'll say Outbreak. I want to hold on to some hope. And I guess Outbreak gives us a little bit of hope. Because they find a vaccine in the end. They contain it. They don't blow up a town. So, yeah, I guess I could watch that and see if we can find our COVID-19 monkey.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think it's really important to experiment and toy with these sort of themes and these sort of reactions and these sort of fears. I mean, I think that's why people use them. I mean, I think when you look at a lot of apocalypses in the 80s, they involve nuclear holocaust because that was a very real world fear. Had someone foolishly launched some missiles, I don't know if that fiction would still exist. So maybe because we're in the heat of one of these plagues, one of these viral infections, one of these things that would be part of an apocalyptic story, maybe that just makes that particular story harder to read. But these other metaphors of it, you know, our giant robots or our comet in the sky, it's telling some of the same story, but it's doing it with a fantastical bent. I don't know. I think they're still unnerving, but it's like maybe I want to be unnerved. Maybe that's okay. It's a way of experiencing these fears without necessarily having to, I don't know. It's a way of experiencing them in the context of a film. It's right. A block of time. It's dealing it with a story, even if the outcome is horrible, dealing it with characters and seeing an outcome gives you a way to work through some feelings. Right now we're in a holding pattern.
Right.
We don't know what's coming next. It's the unknown. It's a huge unknown. We don't know virally. We don't know if we're going to catch it. We don't know what the world is, how it's going to work. Where jobs, all sorts of things are so uncertain that to even follow a downer of a story to its completion at least gives us practice in dealing what it's like. And I think that's an important way of dealing with some emotions right now. It's not the only way. And too much of it would be damaging. But no, I do think watching some of these and embracing some of these is a way to, and it's not solving, it's not feeling better. It's just a way to feel these feelings that we're going to feel.
I get that. I understand that. I think for me, I'd rather not experience it in the film and watch it to the end and turn off the TV, at least not right now, and turn off the TV or turn off the movie and have the TV come on and it's the news kind of sharing the same story I just watched. So for me, it's not really an escape. I get your point about at least you have an ending there where we don't have an ending now. But it's not really the escapism I want right now. The apocalypse movies for me were entertaining before, and then they may be entertaining again, but they're not what I'm drawn to. Again, I think I might be able to watch 12 Monkeys because it's got a different aspect to it. But really, like I was saying before, I'd much rather just sit down and watch 4 episodes of New Girl and forget this whole thing is happening for a little while.
Well, I'm glad it was the topic of the episode for tonight then.
It needed to be. How can we not? It's not something we can avoid. We were gonna talk about Happy Days, Laverne and Shirley, the spin-off television of the 70s.
Blatsky's Beauties, is that what it was called? Blatsky's Beauties, that one with an angel. Yeah. Well, listeners, you could have had that, but instead you got this. But it won't be the only thing we talk about. There'll be other topics. There'll be other things. There'll be maybe cheerier, more upbeat things to speak of in the future. And if you're curious about those, if you'd like to maybe hear those, why don't you go over and visit nahpods.com. What? That's a totally different website
than I normally give. Tim, that's hard for me to remember. What was that again?
That's a different web address, nahpods.com. It stands for Not a Hologram, pods being for podcasts, and that's the new homepage for 20th Century Pop. I'm starting a network of shows, and the first one is the one that Bob and I are doing, and I've been doing for 3 years, so you can find 20th Century Pop at nahpods.com. You can also still find it at 20podcast.com. But you can go there. You can click on the link for the show. The most recent episode is always right up there streaming for you to listen to. There are also links to all of our past episodes, so you can hear any of those that you would like. And also, while you're on that page, if you haven't already, I'd encourage you to click on one of the links and subscribe. Subscribe to 20th Century Pop on Apple Podcasts, on Google Play, on Spotify, Stitcher, whatever way it is you get your podcast. That way you'll never miss a show. We do it every week. Every other week is a new episode, and the alternate weeks are bonus or rerun episodes. But check us out there. Check out the website. There'll be a lot more new things and information that we'll talk about in the coming weeks coming there soon. You can follow us on Instagram and also on Twitter, both at 20podcast. And then if you're curious about Bob on the digital age, here he goes. Here he's going to say something.
Yeah, I'll say something. Yeah, check out the new nahpods.com. It's pretty awesome. There's going to be a lot of cool stuff there. You can follow me on Twitter at RH Canning. What are your apocalyptic movies? What do you want to watch during this self-imposed isolation? Apocalypse or Laverne and Shirley? I want to know. What are you doing?
Those are your only options, but yeah, we'd like to know.
One of those two.
All right.
Thanks, Tim, for giving me that moment.
Oh. everyone needs their Laverne and Shirley moment. Yeah. Glad you got yours. Thanks for doing this today, people. Thanks for listening. And, you know, you don't need a little rinky-dink podcast show to tell you, be careful, to tell you what to do. So this won't be the only thing we talk about. But it came up today. It's on our minds today. And hopefully going forward, maybe we will provide insight into other things to talk about. And I'm sure we'll touch back and touch base on this again. Because it's horrifying. It's scary out there right now. But it can't be the only thing that we talk about. That said, hope you enjoyed that episode that was all about it. I don't know. How's that?
That's perfect.
Okay. Poop fart joke.
We're gonna do it. Give us any chance, we'll take it.